Welcome to the King of Style. I'm June Ambrose, and we are so excited that you're all here for our very first King of Style Roundtable. I'm delighted to introduce our guest, John Branca, co-executor of the Michael Jackson Estate, co-producer of the movie This Is It, the Broadway show MJ the Musical, MJ Immortal, and MJ One. Michael Bush, author of King of Style, Michael's longtime costume designer and collaborator. Rushka Bergman, Michael Jackson's only personal stylist and contributing fashion editor for Vogue Italia. And Kamini, Jamaican supermodel and host and fashion expert. And we are especially honored to have Prince Jackson with us. And from the hit show, MJ Musical, Jamal Fields-Green. Welcome, everyone. So this is such an incredible group of people we have here today. And we want to get into the influence of Michael Jackson's style. Let's take a look at Michael's first creative expression as a solo artist. I have to ask you this question, because it feels like what we're seeing is Michael breaking away from the Jackson 5 and really wanting to find his own, you know, lane. Can you speak to that?
Sure. Michael turned 21 when he made Off the Wall, and he'd supported his family his whole life. He was a loving family member, but at 21, he decided he wanted to step out on his own. So he wrote a note to himself that said, I'm no longer going to be the little cute boy in the Jackson 5. Right. I'm going to be a man. So he made Off the Wall, and he studied some of the greats. That was Michael's way, James Brown, Jackie Wilson. But two of his biggest influences were Fred Astaire and Gene Kelly. So from Fred Astaire, you see the fedora lean that he made famous in Smooth Criminal. But with Gene Kelly, you see the high water pants, the short pants, later the sparkly socks, which put an emphasis on his feet.
I think we're all sitting here rhinestoned out because of Michael Jackson. So you can see how that resonated and it continues to resonate year after year after year. I mean, it's still the go-to pop culture. Even in my music video design days, Missy Elliott, everything had to be rhinestoned out. We would always constantly reference Michael Jackson. Puff Daddy, shiny suits. When I worked on, you know, costume design, those things, we talked about having it have that Michael Jackson effortless appeal. Talk to me a little bit about really kind of taking that to another level.
Well, Michael made rhinestones day wear. Because back in the time, you only wore them at night, at dinner, at nightclubs. Michael made it a fashion statement in daylight.
He brought disco to the daytime?
Yes.
And what I loved as well is the juxtaposition of the crop pant. Now, white socks was something we only used to wear to church. Yeah. You know, you only wore your dress socks for fancy occasions. But Michael did it for what reason? Why was he so disruptive? He was such a rebel in that way.
Michael was visionary. And it doesn't matter if he's going to church or he's going on the stage or he's going on the street. Michael was one of the most iconic fashion icon for all of us until today.
And with Michael, like you said, I'm on stage, I have a black dance floor, black shoes, black pants. If you can't see my feet or my legs or feet move, why am I doing this? Yeah. Just do it on the radio.
Yeah.
So that's where the white socks became, depending on the bigger the audience, the higher the pants came. So the guy in the last row has got to see me dance. So
Wow. Now who knew that that would become an IP? The rhinestones and the gloves and everything became something that was immortalized. I mean,
yes.
Did you see that coming?
No, but I tell you, when Thriller came out and Michael wore the leather jacket, it became such a fashion influence that it was copied around the world.
Yeah.
And it was copied so much, we had to go make a clothing deal for Michael because everybody was copying his style.
Another thing I want to talk about is the effortlessness of his style. You know, it's like he balanced bowls so well in terms of punctuation. Talk to me about like when you were getting dressed today.
The outfit like that represent Off the Wall with the rhinestone in Jamaica. Michael inspired us. Every kid in America, every child wanted a beaded jacket.
What we have next really solidifies Michael as king of pop and style.
Yeah.
Watch this.
awesome. This was awesome.
Just beat it.
Love that.
I don't want you guys to beat it, but I definitely want to get into that. So, John, how does Sly and the Family Stone influence the next evolution for Michael?
What Michael did is he said when he made Thriller, this isn't just for one race, religion, country. This is for everybody.
Absolutely.
So he had Eddie Van Halen from Van Halen play on Beat It. He had Paul McCartney sing on The Girl Is Mine. He brought in all these influences.
Yeah.
The album went on to be the biggest selling album in the history of the world. And sometimes people don't understand how big the Thriller phenomenon was. If you were to take today BTS and Taylor Swift and Kanye and Drake, it wouldn't capture
to name a few,
altogether
right?
Absolutely.
How big Thriller was. In Africa, South America, Japan, Korea, Russia, everywhere.
Wow, I mean, the Thriller jacket, could you put a value on the Thriller jacket?
Well, there were two Thriller jackets. The leather one sold for $1.8 million about 10 years ago.
Wow, is that all?
That's all.
Wow. Do you see artists today, in addition to what he, the artists that he did mention, that continue to do that? You saw Beyonce at the Super Bowl.
I got 450 emails instantly. Why did I put her in something I put Michael in like 25 years earlier? It's like, I didn't do that. When she walked off stage, she said, this is my homage to Michael Jackson. Aww. Influenced me to get where I got.
We talk about haute couture and the runways.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Bauman.
Oh yeah.
I mean, to name a few. I mean, sure, you can riddle off a number, right?
Virgil
Abloh. Yeah. I mean, there were so many iconic moments in that moment. There was the glove. Socks alone was an outfit, right?
So he would walk on stage to do Billie Jean, and then he'd open his suitcase. And when the glove came out, like Michael said, it has its own audience. It got a standing ovation, just the glove, before he even put it on.
And it was protected like the crown.
He said, you know, Bush, if I'm to do Billie Jean and I don't have the glove, you get to walk on stage and tell about 80,000 people why I'm not doing Billie Jean tonight because you forgot the glove.
We've been sharing some really great stories back and forth since we've met, and it's been so fascinating. I'm looking at Rushka now and I'm giggling because, you know, Michael also wore like, you know, his eyewear was a moment too. And you're sitting here with your dark glasses looking so chic. I mean, it's such a style, iconic moment as well. It's the way he did what he worked with accessories, I thought was very fascinating. Like that punctuation was enough. Like a white shirt was like.
But even when he'd step on stage, stand there for 2 minutes and not even move. Wow. And
the crowd's going wild.
Going wild, not even moving yet.
You know, that moment where Michael did that in the Super Bowl, I remember a conversation I had with Scooter Braun, and he was talking about his client, Justin Bieber. And he said, we always sit there and we go, what would Michael do?
Ooh. You know, he had this love affair with the fedora. When the fedora came out, it was such a macho gangster. Because we knew Michael was one way, but then he put on the fedora and he became someone else. Yeah. And every person on the streets, it felt like the fedora had a new meaning. It was like, women
saw the hat on someone's head, you knew who it was.
But I'm gonna go into another accessory that I idolize, the penny loafer. Like when I was growing up, you know, the penny loafer was like a proper shoe.
There's one thing where Frankie Leo came to me as manager and said, would you polish those shoes? So, you know, I'm listening, I polish them. Michael goes, the next show, where's my dance shoes? And I go, here they are. And he goes, no, my dance shoes. And I'm like, he goes, what's on those? And I said, polish. And then I was explained the way he worked his shoes. If I accidentally get shoe polish on the bottom of the sole of my shoe,
very dangerous,
slip and fall, we're all unemployed now.
You
just left the shoes alone. He said, do anything from my ankles up. I don't care, but do not touch my shoes.
That's a great insight moment. I love that. Well, we could probably do a 6-part series on all time periods alone. But after Thriller, Michael really wanted to level up more, which brings us to the Bad era.
that.
Right? Yeah. I was like, the technology, the innovation, the material, the uniqueness. For someone to reinvent themselves over and over and over again, that truly gives you the title King of Style.
With the Bad album, Michael wanted to get tougher, have a harder edge. The album was phenomenally successful, but it's very cutting edge and feels very street, you know, dancing in the subway. But it shows how Michael drew from great influences and made it his own. Smooth Criminal was inspired by a Fred Astaire movie called Girl Happy, where Fred Astaire did the lean and came in and did the bunny hop. The Bad video, filmed in the subway, was right out of West Side Story, Jerome Robbins, except it's done with leather in a subway. But Michael took it, and he took it to another level and made it his own.
I mean, I'm still seeing this play out today. Yeah. Whenever I want a little bit of toughness, I throw on a leather jacket. I mean, I think all of us sitting in here can like relate to like just how a little thing can change. But Michael's little things were big things. They were so impactful. You know, the edgier the look, for him, for some reason, it just felt so different. But that lean, you talk about that lean. Who was around when that lean first took place? Wow. Oh, talk about it.
He goes, Bush, you understand, I have to do on stage what I do in my movie shorts so the fans know I really did it. So we went home and worked on it, frustrated. How are you gonna make this work? Came up with the idea, perfected it, and he went over, and as he was coming up, he started to cry. It was that same thing attitude I learned from Michael. Well, I didn't know I could make it work.
I know, I'm a student right now, and I'm just eating it all up.
People don't understand how competitive Michael was, because he's, you know...
Well, tell us.
Gentle, his voice, very gentle demeanor.
Yeah.
But he was extremely competitive, and he wanted the best from his people. And he used to say, Branko, I'm fixing to hurt these people. And what that meant is, I'm going to go out and put on a show that they'll never forget.
Yeah.
I remember when I was talking to him about Elvis Presley, it was... You know, one of the reasons I got in the business. And he said, you know, of course Elvis was great, Branko, but you know he can't dance like me. He loved Elvis, loved the Beatles, but he wanted to be the king.
Yeah, he competed against the better version of himself. Yeah. Do you still see some of these trends still being, you know, asked for you to kind of recreate or reimagine? Because that's
Absolutely.
What style is all about.
I think so. The clothes come secondary than Michael Jackson as persona, because he was larger than life, so one outfit of one designer is not enough.
He was a fashion forecaster.
No, because after the Bad album, all that came out, Michael's going, okay, what's the next? The new album's coming out.
Right.
And we're looking at magazines, you know, and Michael's going, wait, I'm looking at photos that could be 6-8 months old. And he sent me and Dennis to London, to Paris, and to Rome to go in nightclubs to see what people have on right now. So we're in London going to a nightclub, and you see a group of people and ask, why did you put that on? What inspired you to wear that tonight? The first answer I got was, well, we're waiting to see what Michael Jackson puts on to know what to wear next. Wow. Which was the last thing I wanted to hear, because we were trying to figure out how can we outdo now.
Right.
And now is waiting for him to create the now.
This edgier time period leads us into a phase of Michael's life where we are seeing heavy influence of high fashion. And it's all that time that includes his sister, Janet Jackson. Question for you, Kamini. Like, Michael wanted to really show his influence and have others emulate his style. What are your thoughts about that? Does that influence you? Have you seen that play out? Talk to me about the experience of mixing the high-low fashion and Michael's influence.
It's like taking the simple white shirt. I mean, every job I've done has a simple white shirt. It has a leather jacket, depending on the season. The rhinestones. There is a famous jacket that Michael has. It's at John's house. It's the dinner jacket.
Okay, one night on the phone, Michael was always calling me at 2 o'clock in the morning with a challenge.
Yeah.
So one night he called at 2 o'clock and said, Bush, there's something in the world that every child can identify with. What is it? Michael calls back. What'd you come up with? knife, fork, and spoon. He goes, oh, that's great. Now put that on a jacket for me. So we actually went to the garment district and found charms, little charm for charm bracelets, and put those on a jacket. And he loved it because it made sound, it danced, it moved the way they were put on the jacket. And one night at Neverland, Elizabeth Taylor's at the dinner table, and Michael comes walking down the hall wearing that jacket. And Elizabeth screams, oh my God, Michael, you sound like a Clydesdale coming down the hallway.
He has the best sense of humor, like in the Broadway show.
Yeah, Michael had all these expressions. The quality goes in before the name goes on, which was a famous commercial for Zenith. And he used to say, you know, if Ailey's Comet went by every month, no one would look at it. That's why I don't do interviews. You know, so when I do talk, people are gonna listen. But my favorite line, which she said to me and which we have in the Broadway show, is he would get inspiration and dreams. And he said, you know, God gave me this idea. And if I don't use it, God's going to give it to Prince.
In the 90s, it was a heavy grunge era. And I see the influence of like London and like kind of global influences. And I remember you said you went into the clubs and you were doing some research. I loved how he took grunge and mixed it with high fashion and commercialized it.
But then even I did a project in London a few years ago and have Vienna Westwood come up to me and say, oh my God, I'm very sorry, Mr. Bush, but I ripped your book apart and all those photos are on my inspiration wall of what Michael had on.
Wow.
I mean, it's so humbling too to
know I got goosebumps.
That you have that type of artist in that grunge era.
I was
still looking
fan.
At Michael at that edge. But even with his clothes, you went kind of high fashion, but he said it's too clean, edge it. A little rough, make it a little rebellious.
Rough.
A little.
Yeah, unapologetic.
Michael, it's a shame. I have a copy of your book and I love it. But I went and tried to buy another one the other day. It was selling for $2,000 on eBay.
It's a classic.
Wow. I mean, it's time to republish it. Tell me if I'm wrong, but the jacket that's on the cover was just purchased by Lady Gaga in an auction, I believe?
Yes. There were three made. That one was for photos, the leather one, and there were two for the stage.
Right.
Was stretch fabric.
The jacket that he wore on Motown 25, the famous black sparkly jacket. And you look at that, and it's so iconic, because he'd wear it on tour, and you think, well, you know, what designer, where was it made? It was his mother's jacket. She came home one day
from
and was in a shopping bag, and he put it on and he wore it on national television.
He was huge on the 16th century as well, and he loved like the Renaissance, and you could see the influence of like art in the museums and the referencing. You can see he did his homework. And what I really loved was when he went to the White House in the utilitarian, you know, jacket. And it was really him speaking about his stand on World War and wanting peace, without even opening his mouth. And that's what style is. But it was so powerful. Yeah. Can we talk a little bit about his process and how his influence in the Renaissance and mid-century helped to build out some of those costumes that you designed?
You go in a museum and Michael, because you look at these, you know, in these emperors and kings and the regalia, the clothes.
Yeah.
And it was the artwork on the clothes, the badges and the patches and the amount of artwork on the clothes, which fascinated Michael.
Well, I know for sure you've seen a lot of these utilitarian trends on the runway. We still see them.
Absolutely. I love 16th century. He said, Rushka, which part of 16th century? I said, I love Renaissance. He said, I actually love Baroque. He said that this music was a forever and his inspiration and his clothes and everything.
The next era is just seen everywhere, including on the world's biggest superstars. Watch how Michael's history era is still relevant today. I mean, some of the biggest stars have taken influence from him. I mean, you were talking about it earlier with me.
Yeah, well, one of our clients is Beyonce, and that Super Bowl performance where she did Formation, as she said, was an homage to Michael. We've got a documentary coming out in a couple months. I guess I'll get a plug for it on the Thriller album. We have a segment on Michael's influences, Chris Brown, Weeknd, Ciara, Usher, of course. But there's this wonderful sequence that I love where we put BTS and Michael right next to each other. Mm-hmm. And it's remarkable how many of the moves that BTS do came straight from a Michael Jackson video. And they're the biggest group in the world right now.
I don't think anyone was even trying to hide the fact that it wasn't even a remix. It was just like, it was that good.
The other thing about that history tour, I was on the tour and it went all over the world. We did football and soccer stadiums everywhere. But Michael designed a show that was so big that the only thing that could carry it were these Russian Antonov airplanes. You couldn't fit it in an American cargo plane. And the problem with the Antonov planes is they needed extra long runways. So there were only certain runways that you could land on. And then there was a landing fee. So every time the plane landed, you had to pay $100,000 or $200,000 just for the permission to land. That's how big Michael thought.
Everyone, our incredible panelists for sharing their insightful, exclusive stories. Our audience for being here today. And it's a wrap for our first round table here on The King of Style.
Ha ha ha.